Isn't that the most amazing thing you've ever seen? Well, look what it is. It's the denial of one's twin flame. It is the substituting of the droid, the automaton, in the fusion and in the ritual of the ascension, which in this case is a mechanical ascension. The synthetic self simulates a mechanical ascension because it has no heart flame to achieve it according to the path outlined by the Godhead. Now, if we start with a premise of guilt within the human or within the individual who has a threefold flame, based on some past association with the robot, then what would be the ultimate way to resolve that guilt? It would be to make the sacrifice to give of one's essence to the robot so that now the robot can become one's co-equal in this simulated alchemical marriage and thereby erase the entire subconscious of guilt. And when the subconscious guilt is erased, then there is the rise to a higher plane of being. So it shows how to exit the human octave. And the only way to get out is to give yourself and your light to the robot creation, to fuse with it. And the robot gives you the superior mind, the superior brain, whereby you yourself transcend the human level. It is sheer madness, but it is something that the false hierarchy and the space people above all want mankind to believe. They want acceptability, and they want to get it any way that they can get it. And once they have the acceptability, which they've tried to achieve through ET, through sympathy with robots, you can see the possibility of these beings stepping out of spaceships, being adored as gods, marrying and intermarrying with the people of Earth, accelerating their evolution, and that becomes the happy ending to the human adventure. That is where it is intended to go. That is where it is headed. Without a doubt, in Blade Runner, replicants have won the audience's sympathy. Since man and machine are both mortal, why not go off with one of these specially engineered replicants? The psyche of the audience has been seeded with the idea that it's okay to marry a robot. The same conclusion in Star Trek. In fact, in some cases, it may even be preferable to do so because one will advance the genetic engineering of the human race in the process. We take the best of the human, a threefold flame, and the best of the robot, and we produce offspring that are superior. I'll never forget the trip that we took to Europe in 1968 aboard ship. And the week or so that we spent on ship going, Mark was giving me teachings about this very act of the intermarriage. So there was a couple and three children. The father had a threefold flame, the mother did not. And everywhere we went, we would see these people on deck or at dinner or in the elevator. And you couldn't help but observe this interaction. So there were three children. One of them had a threefold flame and two did not. The one that had a threefold flame gravitated toward the father who had a threefold flame. They had a rapport. And the other two basically were around the mother. And to see the interactions of the personalities and the psychology of this family was really astounding. The intimidation was there. Here is a man who realizes his ultimate dream, the perfect beauty, the perfect woman he marries, status, society, money. He has children, and yet the way it occurs is that some may have a threefold flame and some do not. Not quickened or awakened to his own threefold flame, having residual desire from many past embodiments to have the ultimate in the sensual material existence, he fulfills his own desire and in the process not only establishes a tie to this creation, but creates the karma then with his family for God only knows how long until that life is either free or returned to the great central sun or whatever God has in mind for it. Wherever you do not have a threefold flame, you always have residual hatred of the father and hatred of the mother. You created me and you did not endow me with a threefold flame. I think I'd like to give us an opportunity for a stretch and a song and open the doors and fresh air before I go on with the next analysis. I'm certainly grateful for the opportunity for the masters to give us their very specific and incisive comments against the backdrop of these films. The films seem to bring out specific comments and teachings and answer questions that you've had. So let's sing a rousing song to Archangel Michael to take command. We'll open the doors. You can come and go briefly. Number 298.
Rise to the realm of the mind. I bring back tidings. Hail, Archangel Michael! Hail, Archangel Michael! Hail, Archangel Michael! In the name of the living word, we call to the very heart of the mighty Archangel for the binding now of the fallen ones and their entire manipulation of life on earth, known or unknown. Beloved and mighty Estrella, beloved Archangel Michael, raise your cosmic circle and sword of blue flame. I call for the mighty sword of blue flame of beloved Archangel Michael, cut right through. Bind then the astral hordes of night, bind then the fallen ones, bind those who are rebels against the Lord God Almighty. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, and the Mother, I demand the protection of elemental life, angels of God and sons of God, children of the light on earth. I demand the protection of all those who are of good will, and the binding of the fallen ones by our call. Lord Michael, I call unto thee with thy sword of flame, and I can be playing it out for now into my world, the banner of faith, the bummy and barrel, and then every bunny, the bed of my soul, I am going to raise the right in the moon. Lord Michael, I love thee, and you with all the remaining money, and you playing it out for now into my world, the banner of faith, the bummy and barrel, and then every bunny, the bed of my soul, I am going to raise the right in the moon. Lord Michael, I need the blue, come see me to keep you faithful. Playing it out for now.
It is important for us to go back to the point of guilt, because this is the point where we must undo the spiral of contempt that binds the evolution of the light bearers to the fallen ones. My perception is that this is an accepted guilt, a guilt which is projected by the fallen ones themselves. The fallen angels, the Nephilim, fell, created mechanization man. Later, the Watchers fell, lusting after both the Nephilim and the mechanization man. Somewhere along the line of evolution, the Nephilim gods, their creation with whom they subsequently bore offspring, creating a new strain of part fallen angel and part robot. The combination of Watchers and their mating with the sons of men, mechanization man. This combined evolution, all of whom are referred to as fallen ones, has convinced the children of the light and the sons of God that they are to blame, that the children of the light are to blame for the fall of the fallen angels. You made us do it. It was your fault that we fell. You, the Son of God, and your relationship to the Father got us in trouble, and we got cast out of heaven because of you. Because you came along, because you were born, we were put out of the Father's house. They were put out because they did not bend the knee and accept the Christ as the equivalent of God, as the offspring of God, hence do the same reverence. Somehow there has been an acceptance of that guilt by the children of the light. It has become believable to them that they are accountable for the condition of sinners on the planet. Even so much so that in the book of Enoch, we find that the Watchers apply to Enoch and ask him to intercede for them before the Father. And Enoch goes to the Father and asks for grace and mercy. And the Father replies, Enoch, why are you coming here to ask for intercession for the Watchers? They should come making prayer and intercession for you. This is because they were once mighty angels and were intended to be the servants of the sons of God. So God reconfirms his judgment of the fallen ones, which was meted upon them when they were cast out of heaven. And he says, never shall they be any more. And in the final end, in the last day, they will pass through the judgment and the second death. Enoch, of course, reports this back to them, that he has no luck with a father, he is not able to intercede for them. Now it becomes his fault. And that is the guilt trip they attempted to lay upon Enoch, but he did not accept it. But somehow there is a convincing of the children of the light that it is their fault that the fallen angels and their robot creation are in the estate that they are in. That has got to be the reason for the guilt. I have seen this psychology in families where children of the light, are made to feel guilty for the sins of their parents. And their guilt becomes so great that they spend their entire lifetime attempting to resolve that guilt. And to do so, they will marry someone like their father or like their mother to try to help that person overcome his problems. So guilt becomes the prime motivating force in life that causes great compromises to occur in life streams. Things we would ordinarily not do according to our best judgment, we somehow find ourselves trapped into doing because we feel sorry for the seed of Satan and the sorrows of that seed. And feeling sorry for puts us at that level and gives us the point of acceptance of the guilt. Now you recall this technique of Caiaphas, the high priest, and the watchers who conspired to crucify Christ. They held up Barabbas. Pilate said, "Who do you want, Christ or Barabbas?" They said, "Give us Barabbas." Pilate says, "He is innocent." And the multitude cry out, "His blood be upon us and upon our children." They are manipulated into an emotional frenzy, and at the height of the frenzy, they accept upon themselves willingly and gladly the guilt or the consequences that they must pay for the death of the living Christ. So now they, by their own consent, bear the karma. In actuality, we have received a dictation that states that the cause and core of the death of Christ is upon the watchers and the Nephilim and not upon the Jews. But this dictation did not come for 2,000 years. And in the interim, they bore the karma because they willed it upon themselves. So it is one instance that I can think of where the children of the light accept the guilt for the crimes of the fallen ones. You can feel the pressure of light from the great divine director and Saint Germain in their desire to get our attention on this subject, to use the violet flame on it in the last remaining minutes which we have in 1982. So we go on with the exposure of ET, the extraterrestrial. Director Steven Spielberg has outdone all other previous box office hits with his 1982 motion picture, E.T., the Extraterrestrial. As of December 26th, E.T. has grossed over $311 million. The film cost about $11 million, and Universal financed it. Few films have ever had greater impact. "Until today," wrote one Italian journalist, "Pinocchio was the classic puppet for little boys. Maybe now Pinocchio is finished and E.T. will take his place." E.T. is a combination science fiction fantasy and suspense thriller. It traces the development of a deep emotional bond between a 10-year-old boy and a tiny extraterrestrial marooned on planet Earth. What transpires in 1 hour and 55 minutes on the screen is the chronicle of a friendship between two unlikely beings drawn together by the mutual sense of abandonment. E.T. is left behind inadvertently by his fellow space travelers, and we learn that Elliot's parents have separated and that his father is somewhere in Mexico with his girlfriend. As Gary Arnold of the Washington Post writes, The same visionary impulse that produced Steven Spielberg's wonderstruck UFO movie, Close Encounters of the Third Kind, has now inspired a fresh, delightful variation on the theme. E.T. both films, E.T. Both films are propelled by the need to reach up there or out there to verify the existence of sentient beings beyond our earthly habitat and confirm a spiritual rapport across the cosmos. Spielberg does it masterfully. That's the Washington Post. I'd like to point out that the need to verify beings in other dimensions is within our souls because we know that the ascended masters exist. Enter E.T., who steals the show, takes the place of, is a lollipop replacement for the ascended masters. And once you have E.T., who needs the ascended masters? So it's a carefully calculated plot to establish sympathy for the reptilian creation. I want to make sure that you understand that many people who have had encounters with flying saucers have spoken about people who had reptilian attributes. Such figures also come back to us in Greek mythology and in Atlantis. Beings who have reptilian features and traits. We associate the term serpent also with a reptile, and we know that serpent is a term for a classification of fallen angels. We also notice that Origen taught that angels could fall, and they could fall so low that they were no longer inhabiting human bodies, but lower animal forms, gross and dense bodies. The astral plane itself is noted for its wetness and for the reptilian evolution that is associated with it. E.T. has a distinctly reptilian characteristic, and unmistakably it comes out of the subconscious memory of those who created him of a rapport with fallen ones. Ones who have fallen so low that they are beneath the level of the human species. And yet, even though beneath it in this film, they succeed in elevating E.T. to a status above the human, the status of a god, which of course is what a fallen angel desires to be. It's an amazing thing that one can neutralize the soul's awareness and the subconscious awareness that that which is reptilian comes from below. It comes from beneath. And that which is of light, that which is the Son of God, comes from above. All that awareness of archetypal patterns which are in the subconscious of the race, all of that is neutralized as we look through the eyes of a boy upon this space visitor. The vision transferred through this movie to millions of people across America is, as Arnold suggests, of a universe peopled with myriad beings who, though physically different, all share a common heritage. Now it becomes very important for the fallen ones to repeat the Declaration of Independence: all men are created equal and endowed with certain inalienable rights. E.T. is received with co-equality and then elevated to something above the democratic masses. E.T. gains acceptance by the guilt that is already present, that we must not treat anyone, regardless of how they look, any differently from ourselves. We must neutralize all sense of discrimination which we may find when we come in contact with people's auras and say, it doesn't matter how terrible a person looks or how evil the eye may be, the worse they look, the more we're supposed to feel sorry for them and help them. E.T. becomes a symbol of a being superior to the human, and as one journalist phrased it, E.T. makes a much better friend than a mother, brother, or lover. Now, the truth of the matter is that the best friend any of us will ever have is our guru. E.T. is a better friend than mother, brother, or lover. Who else can he be but a replacement for the guru? Nobody's a better friend to all of these.
Society's heroes seldom fit into the molds designed for them. And nothing could be truer of this than the latest phenomenon to sweep across America, E.T., a creation of the movies.
If you can extend it more, Henry, I think it would sound much more from the heart.
You know, so
I'm so sorry to you.
Yeah.
Believe in you all my life. Every day. E.T. I love you.
Wipe the doll's face, too.
Thank you.
Okay. Movies are so sad. Stay with this one.
When I first met him, I thought, yuck. But then when I really noticed him, I thought he was really nice.
And that's the way most of us felt. Their E.T. dolls, masks, T-shirts, toys, phones. And believe it or not, there's even an E.T. drink. And this summer, all across America, E.T. sandcastles dotted the beaches everywhere. Obviously, E.T. has many things going for him that are lacking in his predecessors. He wasn't violent, dangerous, or bent on destruction. He was very fortunate that when he became stranded, he ran into Elliot, a boy whose heart beat as warmly as his own.
Do you talk? You know, talk? Me, human. Boy. Elliot.
It's 10-year-old Elliot who first encounters a strange presence.
All right. Where's the pizza?
Mom, there's some out there. Oh, it's in the pool shack. They're throwing the ball at me. Oh,
cool. Yeah, no, we're all there.
Nobody go out there.
Stop now. You guys stay right here.
You stay here, Mom. We'll check it out.
And put those knives back. Okay, Elliot. It's cool. Get the flashlight. Hold it. Wait a minute. Come on. Creepy.
What exactly did you see?
Scary. There's nothing in here.
The gate's open. These. Coyotes come back again, Mom.
Okay, party's over. Everybody back inside. Yeah. Tyler, give me that knife.
Oh, great. Nice one, Elliot.
It was an accident.
A pizza.
Yeah.
Who said you guys could order a pizza, huh?
Him.
In the house.
You geeky man.
But, Mom, it was real, I swear.
The star of E.T., E.T. himself, is a creature of magic. And of creation, he's not, you know, we didn't rent him from, you know, stellar central casting. I didn't want to do a movie with some guy running around in a costume. That's not my idea of a creature from outer space. It was very important that I make this creature look like you've never seen anything like him before. And I remember thinking the eyes were very, very important, and going through books and looking at the eyes of Albert Einstein, Carl Sandburg, Ernest Hemingway, and just trying to see what made their eyes special and different from my eyes, for instance. And I think I tried very hard in the molding to give E.T. a benign, wizened, almost the look of a prophet. That was the challenge of the movie, which was to construct a leading man who doesn't throw fits and go stomping off to his dressing room and slam the door behind him. You know, he had to behave and listen to my direction. So I created the perfect actor.
As the creator and inspired puppet master, Spielberg set out to project in his extraterrestrial star the human traits his audience would respond to.
Elliot.
I'm keeping you.
What is it?
He won't hurt you, Gertie. He won't hurt you, Gertie. We're not gonna hurt you. Is he a boy or a girl? He's a boy. Was he wearing any clothes? No. But look, you can't tell. Not even Mom.
Why not?
Because, grown-ups can't see him. Only little kids can see him.
Give me a break.
Well, do you know what's going to happen if you do tell?
Do it, Mike. We have to.
Promise?
Yes.
You promise?
Not only does E.T. bring with him the mysteries of outer space, he has shown us the gentler qualities we treasure most in one another.
Okay, Mom, you can look now.
Fun seeing the picture through E.T.'s eyes and then visually finding a way to show Earth as E.T. sees it in a rather bizarre, perverse way. The first time he ever sees human beings happens to be, unfortunately, on Halloween night.
In E.T., federal agents track the extraterrestrial to Elliot's house. And although they seem foreboding and threatening in their appearance, their actual aim is simply to help and study the creature.
Anyone you want. Spider-Man.
Football.
Fine, fine. We'll just put a smile on her face and try to get through the evening. That's all I want to do.
But to make some of your garlic bread, it's a killer.
Always. You can't ask Kathy to go trick-or-treating in the same old sheet she wore last year.
Can we talk about this some other time?
Now I wish I would have listened in science. Michael.
Guess we should just grab anything. Looks like he can make a machine out of it.
What would make a radar?
How the hell do I know? You're the genius here. You have absolute power, remember?
I found him. He belongs to me.
Doesn't look too good anymore.
Don't say that. We're fine.
What's all this we stuff?
You say we all the time now. Really, Elliot, I think you might be getting kind of
sick.
Look,
he's fine, Mike.
Okay, okay. Forget I mentioned it. Grab that fuzzbuster.
Dad's shirt.
Remember when he used to take us out to the ball games and take us to the movies? We'd have popcorn fights.
We'll do that again, Elliot.
Sure.
Old Spice.
Sea breeze.
An essential factor in the success of ET is the use of music. Loud and emotive, it heightens the visual effects and helps to elicit emotional responses from the audience. A second key factor is the camera angle. The film, for the most part, is shot from the perspective of a child. What you see through the lens of the camera is what you would see if you were the size of a 10-year-old or a 3-foot-high extraterrestrial. The camera angle disarms you psychologically. It takes you back to the mindset of a child, which is a very receptive mode of consciousness. You vicariously experience your own childhood. By bypassing what you have learned as an adult and returning to the age of a 7 to 10-year-old, you are more susceptible to messages in the film. It appeals to everyone's desire to be young again, even for a moment. The movie opens on a clearing in the redwood forest of Northern California, right in the area of Archangel Gabriel's retreat and the Goddess of Purity's retreat. A spaceship in the shape of a large Christmas ornament comes into focus. Its occupants are moving around among the vegetation outside of the ship. These extraterrestrials are 2 to 3 feet high with almost translucent, hairless skin. They have large webbed feet coming almost directly out of their low-hanging bellies and long hands attached to ape-like arms that trail behind them. These creatures have bulbous eyes, enormously convex, similar to those of a frog or Albert Einstein. Their heads are shaped like an oversized eggplant on a long stalk of a neck, and their ears are not visible. Their ears are not visible. They have no apparatus for the hearing of the Word of God. They refuse to listen. Their noses and mouths are ape-like. One unique feature to these creatures is that when they encounter one another, their chests release an inner red glow from the heart region that shines through their skin as an affectionate greeting. As the camera moves in, the extraterrestrials appear to be gathering plants. All of a sudden, car lights swing in the direction of the spaceship. The extraterrestrials hurry toward their ship as men jump out of their car and race toward it. While the extraterrestrials are shown in full, the men are only seen from the waist down. The music indicates danger and tension. One extraterrestrial is separated from his ship by the men, and the ship takes off without him. By showing the men from the waist down, they appear much more primitive than the extraterrestrials. In that way, they are introduced to the audience as the adversaries. The men continue to look through the underbrush, and the lone extraterrestrial conceals himself from them. The scene switches to the kitchen of a middle-class suburban home. Several boys, 12 to 14 years old, are seated at the table playing the game Dungeons and Dragons. The boys are undisciplined, and one boy is in the process of ordering pizza by phone. Rock music is playing in the background. At this point, Elliot walks in and wants to play. The boys say he can on the condition that he go and get the pizza from the delivery man. The rebellious attitude of the children is a major part of the characterization in the film. The adults are seen as the adversaries, and so the rebellious behavior directed against the adult figures appears to be warranted. Elliot goes outside and gets the pizza. On his way back to the house, he hears a loud noise coming from the direction of the tool shed in his backyard. He investigates by throwing his baseball into the shed. Something inside throws it back. He steps on the pizza as he races into the house to tell the other boys what he saw. By this time, Mary, his mother, is there, one of two adults that has any character development in the film. She tells the boys to stay put, but they ignore her and race to the backyard. Not finding anything, they return to the house yelling at Elliot for stepping on the pizza. Mary is an impotent character. She is scattered, hysterical, and unreal. She lacks sensitivity and is unable to communicate with her children. Her weakness helps the audience identify with the children and transfer authority to them. It also may reflect Steven Spielberg's concept of mother. Elliot is determined to prove that he did see something, and later that night, he returns to the yard. He goes through the garden and he encounters the extraterrestrial face to face. Both scream and the extraterrestrial flees. The next day, Elliot jumps on his bicycle and heads for the Redwood Forest. He arrives at the place where the spaceship landed and calls out. He leaves a trail of M&M candies as bait to lure the extraterrestrial to his house. The character of E.T. is already developing, throwing a baseball, screaming as he is also frightened in finding the boy, and then responding and picking up the M&Ms. So he's childlike, and that is the first character trait that makes him lovable. Non-threatening, childlike, and innocent to a degree. That night at the dinner table, the conversation reveals that no one in his family believes that Elliot saw anything. Determined to prove them wrong, he camps out in the backyard, hoping that the extraterrestrial will return. Elliot falls asleep and is awakened by the spaceman, who drops a handful of candies on his sleeping bag. Elliot then coaxes him inside to his bedroom with the candies. He tells him his name is Elliot and puts a blanket around the extraterrestrial. It is evident that some sort of energy is being transferred to Elliot from the extraterrestrial. When he falls asleep, Elliot does also. This instantaneous interaction goes on through the movie. It is eerie, but it is something that is created so that you will conclude that this is a great state to be in, to somehow have this ambient relationship with this extraterrestrial. The next day, Elliot plays hooky and stays home with the extraterrestrial. Elliot tries to teach him about some of the things in his room. When his teenage brother Michael returns from school, Elliot shows him the extraterrestrial. Just as the extraterrestrial steps out, his five-year-old sister Gertie walks in, and both the extraterrestrial and Gertie start screaming. Gertie soon loses her fear of him and brings a wagon full of her toys and a dying chrysanthemum to him. The extraterrestrial resurrects the plant and the flowers bloom. The beginning of the miracle worker, E.T. That night, the children try to find out more about where he was from and show him a map of the solar system. The extraterrestrial takes five round objects, levitates them, and orbits four around one ball above the children's heads. Elliot screams and the balls drop to the floor. Elliot's emotions are becoming merged with the extraterrestrial, and his scream is in response to the extraterrestrial sense that he is being hunted. The next day, all the children go to school, leaving the extraterrestrial alone in the house. Becoming hungry, the extraterrestrial goes to the kitchen in search of food and opens the refrigerator. He pulls out a six-pack of beer and drinks it down. Meanwhile, Elliot is in his biology class. As the biology teacher gives the instructions on frog dissection, Elliot is reflecting what the extraterrestrial is experiencing at home. When he turns on the TV and watches it, the images run through Elliot's mind. As the extraterrestrial becomes intoxicated, Elliot becomes intoxicated and encourages his classmates to let all the frogs go. Pandemonium breaks out, the extraterrestrial watches a passionate kissing scene on television, and Elliot acts it out in the classroom. The scene switches back to the house. Gertie and Mary walk in, and the extraterrestrial is in full view. But Mary is oblivious to his presence. Mary receives a call from the school principal, who informs her that Elliot is intoxicated and that she should come and pick him up. Gertie stays home and finds out that the extraterrestrial has learned to speak a few English words. She takes him up to her room, dresses him in play clothes, and starts playing dolls with him. When Elliot walks in, the extraterrestrial begins saying his name, Elliot, Elliot, Elliot. Elliot teaches him to say the name he has given him, E.T., and E.T. communicates to him that he wants to phone home. Elliot and Michael help him gather the equipment he needs to begin constructing his intergalactic communicator. While they are gathering the tools, Michael remarks that E.T. doesn't look very well. Elliot replies, "Don't say that, Michael. We're fine." The names of the child and the creature are intended to suggest an affinity. By this point, Elliot and E.T. have interlocked metabolisms, and for the audience, E.T. has developed the human attributes of Elliot. By the process of transference, they have endowed him with feelings. In psychology, it has been found that the person without feelings ends up in control, and in the course of the movie, E.T. definitely ends up as the hero. I do want you to notice this. The person without feelings ends up in control of a relationship. It is Halloween, and the children have planned to take E.T. to the forest to set up his communicator. They dress him in a sheet so that he can freely walk about outside. Once on the edge of the forest, Elliot places E.T. and the communicator in the basket of his bicycle. The bike ride is too slow for E.T., so he levitates the bicycle and the pair fly over the trees to the landing site of the spaceship. They set up the communicator and it begins to work, but E.T. receives no response from his friends. The two stay up for a long time looking at the sky. Second miracle of transmutation, that is, of levitation with the bike, and they do continue, and pretty soon there's no need to get excited about Jesus Christ coming, because any minute E.T. may walk in your house and do all those things and more. Elliot falls asleep in the woods, and when he wakes up, E.T. is gone. Meanwhile, his mother has contacted the police. Just as Mary finishes giving a policeman his description, Elliot walks in. Elliot begs Michael to find E.T., and Michael takes off to the forest. He finds him lying in a stream and brings him back to the house. E.T. is dying, and Elliot is too. Michael decides it is time to show E.T. to his mother. When she sees E.T., Mary grabs Elliot and takes the children downstairs. She throws open the front door and is confronted by a man in a NASA spacesuit. Everywhere she turns, another man in a similar suit appears. Soon her house is covered in plastic, and one of the rooms is turned into an emergency operating room in an attempt to save E.T. and Elliot. The scientists begin testing E.T. and discover that he has DNA. The medical team is hysterical and indecisive. Medicine is a masculine profession and usually representative of a father figure. Their inability to play that role contributed to the adversary role the adults portray in the film. The fact that E.T. has DNA suggests that he is in some way related to the evolutions of Earth. Very important and subtle connection. Medical science is unable to save E.T., and his vital signs cease. The moment he dies, Elliot regains his strength. The medical team place E.T. in a plastic bag in a lead coffin and cover him with dry ice. The only other adult that has any character development in the movie, Keys, allows Elliot to spend time with E.T. alone. When Elliot opens the coffin lid and unzips the bag, E.T.'s heart light goes off, and he begins saying, "E.T., phone home." When Keys walks in, Elliot flips the coffin lid down and pretends he is sobbing. The resurrection of E.T. gives him supernatural qualities. It is a parallel to Christ that implies there is something divine about E.T. He then alerts Michael that E.T. is still alive and tells Michael to get in the driver's seat of the van that has been arranged to transport E.T.'s coffin. When the van is loaded, Elliot climbs in the back and Michael takes off. Because of the lack of strong adult figures in the film, the children take the leadership role. The audience sanctions the rebellion and behavior of the children because they are the stronger characters. And by this point, the audience has identified with the children. Not only that, but Americans as a national consciousness are considered to be children. There is a childishness as well as a childlikeness to the American personality, not taking things too seriously, liking to have a good time, not always responsible, creative like children. It's a new generation, it's a new nation. And so the child psychology of America comes to play. And children, or child man in America, are very concerned about their future and what is happening and who will save the nation. So the savior comes in the person of E.T., and it is the child in the film that recognizes him, not the adults. So it's like the nation, America, of all nations, the child nation, is the one that is going to have the right consciousness to receive this outer space savior. A chase scene ensues with the FBI and local police in hot pursuit of the van. Michael and Elliot rendezvous in the park with their three friends who have their bikes. Elliot puts E.T. in his bicycle basket and the five boys take off in the direction of the forest. They seem to have finally eluded the police when they run into an impenetrable roadblock. At this point, E.T. levitates the boys and bikes into the air and they are off to the forest. They land on the forest floor near where E.T.'s communicator has been set up. E.T.'s ship touches down and the hatch opens. Mary, Gertie, and Keyes arrive. Gertie rushes forward and gives E.T. his chrysanthemum and plants a kiss on his forehead. Michael says goodbye and the adults kneel down. They all kneel. E.T. says to Elliot, "Come," and Elliot responds, "Stay." E.T. embraces the boy. His heart light is a brilliant ruby red. He places his glowing fingertip on Elliot's forehead at the point of the third eye and says, "I'll be right here." This is the false hierarchy counterfeit initiation of the guru, Lord Maitreya, Buddha. With Elliot's consent, he deposits himself, the image of himself, in his third eye. This may mean an alteration in the DNA of Elliot, and therefore the beginning of the subsequent manifestation of a new race. He's actually planting his seed, as Maitreya would plant the seed of the Christ consciousness within our third eye. E.T. walks up the gangplank with his flower, and the hatch closes. The movie ends as a spacecraft disappears in the stars, leaving a trail of rainbow lights against the dark sky. When E.T. hugs Elliot, it is not an intimate hug. It's a now, put-down hug that you give to someone you feel superior to. The feeling is not love, it is sympathy. Sympathy, basically, is simulated care. The sympathetic tie to the extraterrestrial opens the way for the false hierarchy initiation of the third eye, forming a bond not only between the boy and E.T., but with the audience and extraterrestrials. Because the boy, Elliot, is now totally identified with the audience. The audience plays the role of Elliot in the film. The audience enters the film and the entire dream sequence through the person of Elliot that represents the soul as a child. Steven Spielberg states, "E.T. always amazed us. When Elliot and E.T. embraced in the film's finale, the entire crew was crying. They were sobbing, not only on the first take, but all the takes. They were in full view of E.T. and how E.T. was being mechanically manipulated. Can you imagine that much transference of a sense of self to a mechanical creation? E.T. was created by special effects artist Carlo Rambaldi and brought to life by modern cinematography. With over 25 years in the business, Rambaldi has designed creatures for such films as King Kong, Alien, and Close Encounters, winning 2 Oscars in the process. He has been called a master effects wizard, and E.T. is his greatest accomplishment to date. But E.T. differs from Rambaldi's other creatures in that he seems to be very much alive. As Spielberg says, all the audience ever sees on the screen is a creature from outer space. That's all we saw, too. I still believe, I always will believe, that he's a creature from outer space. He's real. The genius of Carlo is not that he put a lot of wires and latex together and made a mechanical man, but rather that he created something that's more human than a human being. You must understand something. There was severe reverence on the set shown by everybody, even the guys who swept the floors, towards E.T. Severe reverence. Nobody ever mimicked him. Nobody put a mop over his head or dressed him up in clothes that were not suitable for the occasion. That would have thrown the kids around off. They believed in E.T. the way we believe in Santa Claus, or should believe in Santa Claus. Everybody has such a belief in E.T. as a living, breathing organism that no one would dare go up to him and make fun of his appearance or make fun of his awkwardness. He really did seem to have a life of his own. This is the most amazing phenomena of the entire movie. And of all the movies I have reviewed with you, I do recommend that you see this one and explore the subtleties for yourself and watch its impact or attempted impact on your own psyche. Now, I would like to point out to you that I have observed my entire life that astral entities overshadow or actually combine with mannequins and dolls. If you ever see antique dolls, they all have a personality. They all seem to have an astral entity that is attached to them. It is the beginning of the endowing of the man that is created out of the dust with a psyche. So what obviously has happened here is that by the wishful thinking, by the determination, by the willing of everybody involved in making this film, this creation, this masterpiece, has actually had some alien being, some astral being, assume its identity and become congruent with it. So much so that a forceful presence and a vibration actually is conveyed to people when they look at E.T. Now, you heard the little girl say that the first time she saw E.T., she said, yuck, and then afterwards she liked him. Now, we who know Maury's advice know that you're supposed to trust your first impressions. And her first impression was accurate. Spielberg admits that the movie has messages, and one of the strongest, he believes, is the alternative it offers to the 20th century's depersonalizing technology. Spielberg points out that the movie says, yes, these things can happen today. Don't get locked into the cynicism of the technological 80s. Just when we feel we're all becoming little microchips, E.T. comes along and proves to everybody that we're all made of flesh and blood, and that we were all born with and will die with a heart. Our society is becoming much too technical. I think E.T. is the humanistic answer to the technical revolution. The truth is that E.T. is Steven Spielberg's and Rambaldi's concept of God. The reptilian fallen one. You notice that either Spielberg or one of the individuals said that they had to create a personality that they could control. He had to be in control of E.T. So even though E.T. is his God, he's got to be a God over his God. He has to be over the creation, which is an important psychological relationship between the Nephilim and their mechanization man. Yet E.T. himself, being that creation, has the air of superiority, where he is not going to be bound by his creator. And I can assure you that the alien that is ensouling E.T. has no use for Steven Spielberg or anyone else. He has his own motives and his own devices. The film is also intended to be a social commentary. Spielberg says, "My feeling about the whole story is that if E.T. had not come into Elliot's life, and without Elliot having a father around, Elliot would have gone down a dark road. E.T. filled the gap left by the father who flew to Mexico with another woman, and then transforms the father-son relationship into something much more cosmic." That's probably the most important aspect of the movie for me personally. I think it's critical for our understanding of the movie that we realize that Elliot, without a dad, will go in a very rebellious direction. Well, of course, he created the situation as an excuse to have the extraterrestrial come in. But in other words, for Steven Spielberg, it's perfectly all right to murder the father part, to murder the male authority figure and replace it with a reptilian midget that comes from outer space. So with one fell swoop, Spielberg destroys the father image. He's a cad to begin with. He's off with his girlfriend. He destroys the mother image. She has no authority, no control over the children. She's hysterical. She has no mother flame. So without father, without mother, without beginning or end of days, E.T. is born in imitation of Melchizedek or Enoch or the various ascended masters. In other words, he's better than the rest of us. He has no mother and father. He has a creator. He is one of the gods. The motive of creating rebellion and making that rebellion accepted as a necessity in order for children to overcome the density of adults, adults who just don't understand the new age, adults who just don't understand what's happening in the skies and so forth. The necessity to do that on this scale by Spielberg and his associates shows us a very deep, deep hatred of the mother, a deep resentment of the sons of God, and a hatred of Lord Maitreya, because this is the age of the coming Buddha who is come, Lord Maitreya. And this cosmic relationship that is better than father and son winds up being a false guru and is Chila. I don't know how much better you can get than the father-son relationship. It was good enough for Jesus. It's good enough for us. But in truth, the real father, the real authority figure in our life, is the guru. So the father figure of Lanello himself, as the one who brings the authority of the word, is totally wiped out. The guru is wiped out, the mother's wiped out, and the message is not there either. The message is establish a symbiotic relationship with extraterrestrials. Totally open your chakras to them. Live in and through them, experience through them, and somehow in that you will transcend yourself in place of the figure eight spiral and the figure eight flow of the Guru Chila. In an interview this past summer, Spielberg said, "I wanted E.T. to become a kind of conscience and companion to kids growing up in the 80s. A conscience? What does a conscience do? It tells you what to do, right? It sets the moral standard of right and wrong, and a companion to kids growing up in the 80s. displaces the Christ self, displaces the companions of the angels. Basically, it displaces friendship with real friends, real school friends, real children, real hearts of light. And that simulated heart glowing each time it encounters someone is the ultimate antithesis of the path of the ruby ray. Spielberg has also admitted the film represents the fulfillment of his own childhood fantasies. Childhood fantasies. Evidently, he was not on the quest for God or his son or the living guru or the real living word. From his childhood, he was already tied to the idea of entering into and becoming identified with extraterrestrials. Perhaps he is one himself. Perhaps he is E.T. looking for the ones who left him on Earth a long time ago, and we would rather they had not. What does Spielberg hope to change in society as a result of this film? He says, E.T. is my answer to the stalled space program, because the current administration won't give any money to the space program to allow people's imaginations to soar. All I can do is make movies that bring space to Earth and make it more accessible to the imagination. Until an administration, whether it be this one or the next, starts giving NASA the money they need to explore the universe in future centuries, science fiction is going to be the most exciting form of movie making. I'm making the kind of movies that hopefully will make an impression on young people. Maybe when they grow up, they might choose space science, space medicine, or space administration jobs instead of going into law or politics or auto racing. In other words, Steven Spielberg is out to make life on Earth very mundane, very humdrum, very boring, gets people to think in an otherworldliness whereby we look beyond the immediacy of our karma and the people of the planet who need help, and we have these fantastic ideas of space administration, space science, space medicine. It is the escape from karma. Colonizing other worlds is the laggard's answer to leaving your garbage, leaving your mess, and going on to another world and starting all over again. You know, there are always people who move with a certain regularity. They live in a house so long until it's saturated with their vibrations and filled with their junk that they have to move. Did you know there are people like that? So they get up and move, they leave their records in the house, they leave their junk, they start over somewhere else, and they stay there so many years and they can't take it any longer. Well, that's indicative of a non-responsible consciousness. And that's what the laggards have done. They come to this world, they go to another, they've been to others, they mess it up, they destroy it, they land in another, and they start all over again. The idea that E.T. embodies divine qualities has been addressed by several journalists, but none of them have drawn the comparison that Professor Albert E. Millar, Jr. has. Millar wrote a 4-page pamphlet describing 33 similarities between E.T. and Jesus. We tried to get a hold of the pamphlet, but he's being sued, I guess, by Spielberg and his company. And the pamphlets are nowhere to be found. I think it's easy to see the similarities. You might go to the movie with your tape recorder in hand and quietly dictate into it your observations as you see them, because they come very fast. Well, the next movie I'd like to review for you is Tron. And I know it's a bit late, but if I don't do it now, I won't do it. Because I'm just as tired of this as you are. I'd like to get on with a violet flame and clean it up. It's a problem that's been here a long, long time. I want you to know that I refused to go and see these movies when they came out. And I got the assignment to do this, and then I was forced to look at them. And when I finally looked at them, I said to myself, this has to be exposed. It has to be dealt with. It's something that cannot be ignored. Tron cost $22 million to produce, received mixed reviews, and was a disappointment at the box office. Howard Zimmerman, editor of Starlog, one of the leading science fiction magazines, recently wrote, If E.T. was the biggest film of the summer, then Tron was the most important. To my way of thinking, the films represent different sides of the same coin. Both are in response to the vast and unsettling pace of cultural and technological changes. The old values have been lost, leaders don't know the answers, a clear vision and societal goals are missing. E.T. responds to the situation by turning its back on the brave new world of the 80s, by seeking out some of the lost values. Tron, on the other hand, embraces the new technology and shows that the individual may still keep his humanity and control the electronic servants that are changing the face of our world. It is a positive approach. It contains a strong positive message about individual potential and personal power. And on top of all that, it is visually stunning. I think the appropriate adjectives would be unique and revolutionary. Tron, billed as the prototype film of the future, is the first motion picture to rely on computer graphics to produce its special effects as well as most of its soundtrack. Writer-director Steven Lisberger boasts, 15 minutes of this film have never been touched by human hands. That portion of the film contains moving images completely generated by computer. 68 minutes of the 96-minute movie consists of animation done purely by electronic means, without resort to pen, pencil, or brush. For that amount of time, Tron takes place in a new dimension, a world where computer programs are human-like characters and where physical reality is simulated by electronic energy. To achieve these effects, the actors, led by Jeff Bridges as Flynn, Bruce Boxleitner as Alan Bradley and Tron, Cindy Morgan as Laura and Yuri, and David Warner as Dillinger and Sark, had to perform their most complicated actions on a bare stage with only a neutral backdrop behind them. These sequences were shot in black and white. Colors, glowing circuitry, or vector lines, and interactive effects were all added to the black and white live action shots by means of a backlight animation, frame by frame.
In Tron, the line between imagination and reality disappears. The young writer and director of Tron is Steven Lisberger.
Every one of us is in that computer somewhere, whether it's because of our driver's license or social security or income tax, but the fact is that there is an alternate person that is an electrical person that is forming inside this electrical dimension. And then the question is, are you in control of that information or is somebody else in control of it? When thinking about Tron, you sort of have to picture yourself inside a Pac-Man game. Picture yourself in there fighting for your own life. And the only way you can get out of that game is if you figure out how it works from the inside this time. The big difference is the game doesn't look the way it looks to you from this world as a little screen. This time it looks real.
Hey, who's that guy?
That's Tron. He fights for the users.
Tron?
What happens in Tron is that the character Jeff Bridges plays, a guy named Flynn, has invented these various video games, and they've been taken away from him illegally by a large computer company.
I still do not understand why you want to break into the system.
Because, man, somewhere in one of these memories is the evidence.
And in an effort to release the information from their computer files, he takes on their computer system. And in so doing, he gets pulled into the computer. Once he's in that computer, he gets sentenced to die as a video game player by the master control program.
Then pull yourself together. Get this clown trained. I want him in the games until he dies. Play. Acknowledge.
Acknowledge, master control.
Kill him.
And the irony is that those video games are his creation, and now his life depends on overcoming, you know, his own creation.
Okay, here's an easy one.
Tron is using a computer simulation to create backgrounds and ships that would have normally been created by miniatures or models in films such as Star Wars or Star Trek. The computer thinks of all of these objects as three-dimensional objects. There is no limit to the point of view to the camera. There is no limit to the physical realities of the objects. Physical objects can pass right through each other. They can do physically impossible things.
All right, faster, get it!
The characters are being created of light. Our expression is, it's painting with light. And that is a different way to create a physical entity than has ever been done in any other type of film. And then where it really starts to be magic is when you can take images from real life and combine them with computer simulated images to create whole new things. One object can metamorphosize to become another. My expression for the things that the computer can create are that they remind you of something you've never seen before.
Become more powerful, and as the artists get to learn more about them, I think that what's going to happen is that these realities are going to become more spectacular.
Flynn gets trapped into this computer by a technology that is discovered of using a laser beam, and it's shown before he is trapped. They succeed in disintegrating an orange and reintegrating it again. So when he tries to make his final probe of the computer to prove that the head of the company stole his invention, the mastermind of the computer directs a laser beam at him, dissolves him, and recreates him at the microscopic level. And at that point, we experience what seems an interminable time inside of this computer. And the sense to my psyche and my soul is of being trapped inside a computer at a microscopic level of identifying with the hero who goes through the whole Armageddon of good and evil and finally overcomes and is victorious and breaks the code and once again steps out of the computer and has the evidence and therefore proves that the head of the company is a fraud, and then he himself becomes the head of the company. So it's a victorious conclusion that man overcomes the machine. But what is so disturbing and so discomfiting to myself is to have to watch this whole thing and to realize that it is microscopic life. And of course, what Steven Lisberger says is that it is his intention to show that a part of us exists electronically in a computer, and that we do already have an electronic identity at the computer level, because a computer stores information about us, which is an interesting idea. But to accept oneself confined and imprisoned by the mastermind, the face that you saw, and to have to go through this war inside this computer in order to retain life is one of the worst nightmares. I find that if you identify with it, it is tension building. So, reviewing the story again, a computer whiz named Flynn created 6 video game programs which he stored in the computer system of ENCOM, a huge communications conglomerate where he was employed. His rival, Dillinger, stole the programs and rose to become chief executive of the company. Flynn was fired by Dillinger and now runs a video game arcade, where you saw him. He is trying to get evidence to prove Dillinger's guilt, and in the course of his investigations is transported inside of the computer. As the movie opens, you find yourself looking at a world you've never seen before. It is a mixture of fantasy and reality. The characters are human, but the setting is the interior world of a computer. It is a realm where computer programs are alter egos of the programmers or users who created them. So you find yourself imprisoned inside a computer with people who represent either programs or those who created the programs who are users. The programs respect the users as gods. And so Tron, or Flynn who enters, is a god because he created the programs. It is a world dominated by a master control program, MCP, one initial different from MLP, MCP, whose murderous henchman, Sark, is the counterpart of Flynn's adversary, Dillinger. It's just like a bad dream. The MCP was a small-time chess program originally created by Dillinger. By stealing the knowledge of thousands of other programs, the MCP slowly began to take power into its own hands. It's like saying that the one who rises to become the Son of God or the Ascended Master does so by stealing. This MCP of this master control program is a giant of a figure, like a mastermind, and he's planning to take over the world, besides doing what he's doing in this instance. Its immense knowledge has intimidated Dillinger, who has become his obedient servant. So you see this head of this corporation being the servant of the computer, worshiping him and doing his bidding. Identical scenes to what you would have seen in ancient Sumer of either mechanization man or children of the light who sold their souls, bowing down before the Nephilim gods. It's immense. The MCP boasts that he is 2,415 times as smart as the average human and able to run the world, according to his calculations, 900 to 1,200 times more efficiently. As the action begins, we see a lone tank careening down an unearthly canyon in this electronic world. Its driver, a man dressed in a blue uniform, is heading for a restricted zone. He's after a missing program for his user. Suddenly, he is spotted by two immense machines, recognizer robots. After a chase, they destroy his tank, and guards take him to the MCP. When he refuses to talk, the MCP kills him by electronic deresolution, disconnecting him from the power source. The MCP rewards his henchman Sark with extra voltage, and Sark reels, drunk from the infusion of power. It's like a transfer of light. You don't need an ascended master, you can get it from the MCP, drunk with light. Back in the real world, we watch as a helicopter lands on the roof of the giant NCOM complex. Dillinger emerges. He heads for his office and makes contact with the MCP. The MCP tells him of the attempt to break into his restricted zone and orders Dillinger to withdraw all high security clearances. Dillinger obediently obeys. Dillinger calls Alan Bradley to his office and informs him of the new restriction. Bradley demands to know why, and Dillinger replies, "A security precaution." He explains that someone is trying to break into the computer's restricted files. He then asks Bradley what he is working on, and Alan explains that he has just about completed work on an independent security check program named Tron. He mentions that Tron can also check up on the master control program. The MCP overhears the conversation. When Alan leaves, it warns Dillinger that Tron can never be implemented. The MCP won't allow any user or program to interfere with its plans to steal sensitive information from the Pentagon and the Kremlin. Alan immediately contacts his girlfriend Laura, who is working on laser research in another part of the NCOM complex. He informs her of Dillinger's recent mandate, and she thinks of Flynn. She persuades Alan to take her to Flynn's place because she believes he is the only one who might be trying to break into the NCOM system. At Flynn's place, Laura and Alan confront Flynn and learn that he has been the one trying to break into the system. His reason? In order to retrieve the evidence he needs to prove that Dillinger stole Flynn's 6 video games, whose sales success catapulted him to the top position in the company. The three of them agree to break into ENCOM and help Flynn get the evidence he needs. The threesome enter ENCOM using an electronic device that Flynn invented. Laura takes Flynn to her computer terminal while Alan heads for his. The plan of action is for Flynn to free the Tron program and for Alan to give it new instructions to find the missing files. When Flynn tries to access the system, the MCP zaps him with a laser beam. He is dematerialized and transmitted into the interior of the computer, where he rematerializes. He finds himself surrounded by guards who lead him away to a cell. Sark receives orders from the MCP to train Flynn for the games. The MCP sentences its enemies to the system's game grid, where they are forced to fight as combatants in deadly video wars. Sark is reluctant because Flynn is a user, i.e., he is human. The MCP threatens him with deresolution, and Sark willingly complies. In the computer world, there are still a few programs who believe in the users. The MCP is trying to wipe out faith in the users and does so by consigning believers. He does so by consigning believer programs to the game grid. Faith in the users is mocked by those loyal to the MCP. Believers are accused of being religious fanatics. And so several times the religious fanatics are hauled off. And what they are believing in, the programs are believing in those who created them, which is normal for the creation to believe in its creator. And so it's again coming between that relationship, that intimate relationship, by the MCP who represents the ultimate Nephilim God. As RAM, an actuarial program for an insurance company assigned to the game grid, phrases it, "There's only one crime, and that's believing in the users who wrote us. If we refuse to acknowledge the MCP's power, he takes over our functions and then shoves us into the games to have the bits blasted out of us." On the game grid, the contestants sometimes race on light cycles that move with the speed of light. Other times they face off in the ring game, a form of high ally with deresolution as the price of failure. Deadly grid bugs stalk the unwary in this world where logic probes and recognizers are the weapons of oppression. The only way out of the system is the input-output tower, and that is controlled by the MCP. Flynn watches one game, is impressed by the success of one player named Tron. He gets word to him that he wants to meet with him. Flynn encounters Tron and tells him of his plans to destroy the MCP. Tron tells him he has been assigned to take on the MCP, but to do so, he must reach the input-output tower so he can reach his user, Alan, for additional instructions. They join forces and battle the MCP's trained killers on the game grids. Flynn gets separated from Tron, but manages to put together a broken recognizer robot, which he uses to transport him to the tower. Meanwhile, Tron has reached his girlfriend Yuri and freed her from the somnambulant state that the MCP keeps all of his workers in. This is the ultimate totalitarian state that is seen and therefore outsmarted by the Son of God. He asks her to help him get to the tower, and she tells him to wait until that night when Dumont, the keeper of the light, will be alone. Dumont is the only one that can give them access to the tower. With the aid of Dumont, Tron reaches the input-output tower and contacts his user. Tron receives a golden beam of light from Alan, giving him new power. Then he is off to the MCP with Yuri, where they are joined by Flynn. The MCP is housed in the central computer. It is depicted as a turbine-like blur of a head that represents all the evil potential of artificially created intelligence. In the final scenes inside the computer world, Tron confronts Sark at the central computer. In a deadly game of discus, Tron defeats Sark. In a surprise move, the MCP ensouls Sark, and Sark, now twice as large as before, stalks Tron. At this point, Flynn enters and leaps into the MCP's beam, giving Tron the opportunity he needs to hurl his disc into the MCP and destroy him. With the MCP removed, the system is cleared and the programs once again can receive commands from their users. New energy and life lights up the computer world. Flynn finds himself back seated before Laura's terminal. On the computer screen is the information he needs to indict Dillinger. He prints it out, tears it off, and rushes to Allen's office. The movie ends with Allen and Laura on the roof of NCOM, waiting for the helicopter to land with their new boss, Flynn. Seems rather simple and old. Nothing new under the sun in terms of movie plots. But so complicated a computer technology to produce this. It's the most amazing film you'll see technologically. It's unique, and nothing has been produced of its kind. The film deified human beings. The users or computer programmers were gods to their programs. The creations or programs had as much human emotion and empathy or more so, than the one human who was trapped in the computer world. But the human was capable of miraculous powers, which distinguished him from the programs. Tron depicted man as the ultimate source of life and death. There was never any mention of a higher reality. The heroes in the film were what the director conceived of as the prototypes for 21st century heroes. The major attribute of all three was their human genius, quite a change from the brawn heroes of the 20th century. By their genius, they were able to have the good life, money, and success. The film's moral is, man triumphs over machine, demonstrating that man still can control his creation. According to Dennis Armstrong, a writer for the Episcopal News, the underlying moral of Tron is thus that we make the worlds in which we find ourselves. Society, like a computer program or a film, is a creation. Transformed worlds require transformed people. And for that, the film makes clear we may need some outside help. If Tron is an archetypical Armageddon, it somehow misses the mark of establishing an identity of the faithful and true. Something above the human equation of the struggle of relative good and evil. To me, it leaves something to be desired, and it leaves me with that feeling I explained of imprisonment at the microscopic level. Of course, it is supposed to show this, and it's supposed to show what life is like under a totalitarian mind. Perhaps it's the best of the films, perhaps not. I really can't say that I come away from it inspired. It was certainly not the success that E.T. was. It was not the violence, in one sense, that Blade Runner was. I think Blade Runner cuts much more to the core of the psyche, to the very interior of self. E.T. establishes the sympathetic rapport, and there is some hope, however slight, that in Tron we can still overcome the machine. I don't personally feel it's that convincing. However, in conclusion, we have to realize that art is never neutral. And film art, as we have learned, plays upon our subconscious guilts. The giant screen and loud music disarm our defense mechanisms, and we find ourselves flooded with emotion. We may laugh, cry, shout, or applaud and walk away from the theater, gratified for the mere entertainment. But the images and mindset implanted in our subconscious will continue to react to their subtle messages. Today, millions of Americans have a new outlook on extraterrestrials, thanks to E.T., and a new conceptual framework of the future, a la Scott and Lisberger. I think that there is no question that the false hierarchy and the false hierarchy of space people use the violent impact or the subtle impact or the connections or all of the things done in these three movies to create an opening in the consciousness for them to step through and astrally control the people of God upon Earth. I think that just as E.T. picked up an entity, an alien of some power, that now has the world feeding him their attention, that there are also powerful forces that would attempt to invade our life streams through such motion pictures. I can only say in conclusion, an additional conclusion, that while all of this was going on, I think that 1982 will be remembered in the film industry for the production of the movie of Mohandas Gandhi. This is the great all-time film that I hope you will see if you have not already seen it. It's a joyous experience in the life of a servant of the Great White Brotherhood. Before we leave this subject, I'd like to give the opportunity to Dr. Yaney to take the microphone and give any additional comments on the psychology of these films.
The nature of a dream, as Mother has indicated to you, is such that the person is both the viewer at once, the person that one's own, you might say, manufactures one's own dream, actually is the writer. Then one places oneself in the dream, you might say, as the actors, and then stands back, you might say, and observes the whole plot, you might say, the whole stage setting. And this is the way we understand the psychology of dreams, and this is the way we begin to try to analyze them. One can take the same concept and translate it into, for example, a movie. As we've heard revealed here today, the authors and the writers, which are mostly under the direction of the producer and the person that actually made the movie, really is producing, actually, you might say, a dream in its completeness and condensation. And it can actually be analyzed in the same way. So it's been interesting to me to pursue a little bit further the point the mother raised, which is that the race memory is really involved in these movies. And I don't have a whole lot more to add except to add one point, to analyze one point. That, for example, in the movie The Blade Runner, we see that there is a conflict in the dream material. There's always a conflict that is presented to the person, and then there is an attempt to find the solution. So we have to ask ourselves, what is the conflict that's presented, for example, in each of these three movies, and what is in common? Well, in the case of The Blade Runner, the conflict is spelled out. There has been a miscreation of a mechanical race that is basically illegal and is out to destroy not only the creator, but perhaps cause trouble to the planet. Now, that's a very familiar message that we've been hearing. So, in effect, the boys in blue, Archangel Michael's forces, you might say, are appointed to eliminate these dangerous aliens and this miscreation from the planet. And then, of course, we get into the whole structure of the why is that a conflict? Well, it's a conflict because the person appointed to do the elimination develops a sympathetic tie, you might say, to the person he's asked to destroy, the miscreation. And he gets involved with them. That, again, is the old story that we've heard here. So this particular movie, I think, is most out front in revealing to us what is the conflict. In other words, what's the racial conflict? And the end product is a solution within the structure of the dream, and I say the dream in relationship to the dream of the author of this movie. is to unite with that person he's asked to destroy. And so get mixed up and say, well, they're really not so bad after all. It's really okay to have intercourse with this, with them, and the end result is it's really okay just to live with them. But you're brought back, the dream then brings you back to, at the very end of the movie, to the final conflict to start out to solve, which is the fact that the price of a failure to obey God, you might say, and destroy the miscreation, mechanical miscreation, is that he has to leave and escape with a girl. He has to go off to a far distant location, and there's some implication somebody might be after him. So it's kind of an interesting picture that the dream doesn't really give the solution. And it is the nature of dream material that I've seen so often in patients I've worked with in psychoanalysis attempting to analyze their problems, that a dream will be repetitive. In other words, it's almost as if the Christ self within has to give you the same problem all over again. If you don't solve it correctly, you hear the same dream again and again and again, until finally there is something worked through in the outer consciousness. So we see in the case of this Blade Runner dream, shall we say, that we're going to hear it again, because there is no solution. The solution is not successful, really. Uniting with the miscreation is not a solution. And that's the old racial memory that is reoccurring. Now, in the case of E.T., this analyzing this particular point, again we see the boys in blue opening up at the beginning of the dream. It's the same scene all over again. The ship arrives, and E.T. is somehow separated from the ship, and you view all the men that are attempting, again, the boys in blue, and the police officers with their handcuffs and their jingling guns and all their equipment is viewed right at this level. And they're seen as at one hand they represent the apprehension of the spaceship, which should not be there. In other words, there's something wrong with it being there. And of course we see almost that repeated again at the end of the movie. Now this doesn't show itself quite as clearly. In the case of Tron, it's again less clearly defined, except that there has been it's almost reduced to the classic game that Mother described of Armageddon, and the almost a kind of the good guys against the bad guys. So it doesn't have quite that theme that I've described as a race memory in this particular situation. I think that's really that's the main part of this particular point. The other point that I would like to mention is the degree of the use in the case of the Blade Runner, of the violence that so causes you to confuse yourself and confuse the mind as you actually watch these movies. You finally can't decide which side is correct. In other words, if you're going to identify with the hero in the movie, you finally get confused at some point because the violence, actually like you're living out his experience, reaches a place where you can't really think clearly anymore. And so you finally give up, and the solution is to really unite. But really nothing really makes sense. And that's kind of the solution all the way through. I don't think, Mother, I have anything further really to add to your magnificent presentation here today.
Thank you, Ralph. I did have a point that came to mind when you were speaking, which you might wish to comment to. And the idea is, I was trying to define the uncomfortability I felt of being a prisoner at the microscopic level, and what that would have to do with a race memory, which you felt was somewhat thin in that movie. And It came to me that the race memory is that we have an inner awareness that the real level of enslavement of the race is at the microscopic level in the genetic code, because the image of Christ is impressed upon us and carried and transmitted by us through the genes physically and through the heart flame spiritually. And we transmit to ourselves daily, as well as our offspring, our Christ consciousness through the heart flame and our Christ consciousness through our genes. And so what we see the plot of the force is and has been and was done in the ancient times by the fallen ones was to genetically imprison the Christ matrix and render it distorted or incapable of being expressed physically, and therefore distortion at the normal level of our identity is really an imprisonment at the molecular DNA level. And I think this film cracks that wide open and makes us realize we have to do astrayas on the DNA chain, on the seat of the soul chakra, and on our procreative faculties, our ability to transmit the image of our Christhood to new generations of light bearers incoming. It's very uncomfortable to think about. It's the same thing we understand in terms of the robot virus. A virus is a robot creation created by the fallen ones, the scientists. And it, if you look at it under a high-powered microscope, you will see that it looks like a little mechanical man. And it enters the cell and does war against the components of the cell, the white corpuscles.
I'd like to respond a little bit to that point in terms of the boring quality that we saw in Tron, and my experience that to feel that same boredom, and when you might say, is this going to be over? When's this going to end? You say to yourself. It's almost like you really don't see an out, is the personal experience I had while I was watching that movie. And it reminded me very much, Mother, of 2001 when I saw that movie. And it had some of the same feeling when they were battling the computer, actually, of the astronauts inside the spaceship. And there was that same quality of, when is this going to be over? So it's that may have a racial memory, too.
The funny thing about it...
I guess it's not mine alone.
The funny thing about 2001, you can't wait till the movie's over. It's so long and drawn out. And you can't wait to get out of it, but you realize that what you're seeing is almost infinite space, but it's an astral slice of space. Mm-hmm. And no matter how vast this astral slice of space is, you still can't wait to get out of it, and you feel confined.
Trapped.
And I don't think anyone who has ever contemplated the first passenger ride in space across the solar system has ever contemplated that his reaction to the whole scene would be one of immense confinement. Supposedly, it's supposed to be a grand opening to eternity, but it isn't. As long as you're in matter and in the astral plane, there is really no way out. You have to discover the trap door, as Mark used to say, the trap door to the ascension, the trap door through your Christ self. Okay. I'm actually more comfortable and less confined in my physical body than I am in these psychic trips of these movie producers. They're really psychic. That's the ultimate stamp on all these movies. They're psychic. Because they play upon the psyche and they work through the emotions. It's the definition of psychic.
I would like to add just one more point about about E.T. that I was so impressed with the absolutely incredible numbers of symbols that were received and messages received throughout that entire movie. And it was just very hard for one to be not identify and be pulled into the entire structure of that and not come away with a very positive identification for the extraterrestrial evolution. And that man really was he's really the one that's mucking around down here. We are nowhere, and that group is everywhere. And yet it did take the place, as Mother so well pointed out, of the Christ and the the upward movement. You almost have to see that movie to really feel that grip and that warmth that you almost feel towards E.T. And of course, it is that almost a red glow, orange red glow that comes out. And at one point, I thought I saw in the heart almost perhaps a subliminal of Mother Mary's Immaculate Heart. It's quite possible they put that in there somewhere. That may be my picture of it, but that's the way it struck me at one particular point. They had all kinds of other images, and it's interesting that Einstein was mentioned by the author as having been used to mold the face. And if you looked at very closely at the boy that was Elliot, the face of Elliot, the side shots of Elliot, and the face of E.T., it was almost as if they really took the mask off of Elliot's face and they put it on E.T. The broadness of the forehead and everything, there's quite a bit of similarity. So you're forced to identify, you're just absolutely turned, pulled, twisted to identify with E.T. because you have to identify with Elliot. So E.T. is an automatic.
Okay. You know, Ralph, one of the things that my mother told me, she said, when you're judging character and you look at people, don't judge by their faces, judge by their hands. You can tell everything about a person by their hands. The study of the hands is quite a science. I have never really gone into it with any degree of zest. But hands are really amazing. And the hands of E.T. that are shown, silhouetted, ape-like, reptilian-like, very unpleasant, do reveal the nature of the beast. Now, I have seen in a modified version hands like that on a number of individuals in embodiment. And I can remember seeing hands like that and being very much turned off by the vibration of those hands and very much sensing a sinister element. And then I can remember correcting myself and saying, don't think such thoughts about such people, about these people. You know, you should love all people equally, and you should not take exception to someone simply because they're under-endowed and they happen to have ugly-looking hands. So I think that it is important to realize that most people who are extraterrestrials in embodiment have definite marks in the body, just as the Buddhas have marks and signs as well. And those marks are clear. They can be read. Our souls know what they are. God put a mark on Cain. He put the mark of Cain on him so we would all know the seed of the Cainites. We all know what it is at subconscious levels. And on the surface, we neutralize it. We refuse to accept it. We refuse to see it. We turn off our alarm system. And we don't want to look or hear or see. And that's unfortunate because we really do have a lot more Christ discrimination than we realize. I think that most people in this audience agree that Ronald Reagan, for instance, has in many areas betrayed the nation and betrayed his own platform. And I think the most amazing giveaway of what he is the soft-spoken, soothing voice that belies the fact that beneath it all is a very virulent force that moves through him in an anti-light measure. The betrayal of Taiwan, failure to challenge Israel and Begin, many, many situations, the failure to take up the abortion issue when he gained many votes by it, all kinds of things. The betrayal of his own position on mending the economy. Very, very questionable in his behavior, his actions. His actions in no way fulfill his words. And yet there's that quiet, soothing voice, almost similar to Hal. Every time you hear him speak, it's intended to be disarming. And it's a false comfort. There is no comfort in his presence. For me, in any case, I speak for myself and not for all of you. But But there's no comfort for me having Ronald Reagan in the White House. Except as a lesser of evils. I mean, we know it could be worse. The problem is it could be a lot better. Do you want to add anything?
Along the line of that comforting voice, E.T., when he was being trained by Elliot to speak, the word home kept coming up, except it sounded like ohm.
That's true. It was very pleading.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, all of us long for home. The great central sun mm-hmm. and places we cherish, so we empathize with it. Well, it's an immense impact, and the light bearers are going to have to make a bigger impact. They've thrust us a challenge. Keepers of the flame, what do you say? You going to accept the challenge?
Yes.
Good. We've determined to do so also. Thank you, Ralph. Thank you for being a wonderful, wonderful audience. Thank you for being more than an audience, wonderful friends of light.